I would like, on behalf of the University Diabetes Outreach Program, to welcome all of you to this, our fifth scientific session, which is dedicated to providing for you the Sir Phillip Sherlock Distinguished Lecture. I'm Dr. Alverston Bailey, and it is my special honor and privilege to be asked to chair this session and to read the citation to Professor Everard Nathaniel Barton, to whom we will confer the Sir Phillip Sherlock Distinguished Award. You know, you had a good time yesterday, and I was advised that for some of you, the science was a bit heavy. Therefore, we are going to tweak the information somewhat so that we can all be on board when we expose you to heavy pharmacodynamics and toxicokinetics. Okay, it's my special honor this morning to read the citation to Professor Everard Nathaniel Barton. Professor Barton obtained a Bachelor of Science degree in Chemistry and Zoology at the University of the West Indies. He then went to the University of Ibadan, Nigeria's premier university, where he completed his medical undergraduate studies, earning the MBBS. After completing his internship at the University College Hospital, Ibadan, he began his stellar career as a physician at a provincial hospital, an outpost of the teaching hospital, where he observed the practice of medicine in the Cameroon and Kenya. He then migrated to the Caribbean, where he worked for 6 years at the Port of Spain General Hospital in Trinidad and Tobago. In 1989, he moved to Jamaica to pursue the doctorate in internal medicine at the University of the West Indies, Mona. Thereafter, he was awarded a Commonwealth Fellowship to subspecialize in nephrology in England and returned to Mona as a lecturer in medicine. In 1997, he was promoted to senior lecturer with tenure, and in 2001, was promoted to professor of medicine and nephrology. In 2004, he was appointed as head of the Department of Medicine, a position he held until 2010. In 1999, he was appointed editor-in-chief of the West Indian Medical Journal, a position he still holds. With few nephrologists in Jamaica, he was moved by the long distances patients with kidney disease had to travel to see a specialist in Kingston. And so, in 2000, he initiated, with permission from the Ministry of Health and the respective health authorities, the Department of Medicine Voluntary Outreach Projects at the Mandeville Regional Hospital, and later at the St. Ansby Hospital, and these have continued to date. In 1999, he initiated the Caribbean Renal Registry and wrote the first survey of renal disease in Jamaica. With support from the National Health Fund, and later Chase, he invited eHealth Portfolio to develop a web-based rural registry and travel the Caribbean, meeting with relevant stakeholders to arrange training for its use. Professor Barton is the founder of the Caribbean Institute of Nephrology and was instrumental in planning and hosting the first international conference on nephrology and hypertension, which is now in its seventh year. With support from the International Society of Nephrology, he was able to get nephrology in Jamaica at the University of the West Indies linked with a sister program at the University of Michigan. This has brought scholarship and training opportunities for many postgrad students. Our distinguished awardee is a noted pioneer in bringing well-needed nephrology services to patients throughout the island, developing renal units at the Cornwall Regional Hospital, the Diabetes Association of Jamaica, the St. Joseph Hospital, and the Mandeville Regional Hospital, all of which offer dialysis to patients. Further afield, he assisted Anguilla, Trinidad and Tobago, and the British Virgin Islands to develop their dialysis program. He continues to organize many screening programs for hypertension, diabetes, obesity, and kidney disease, especially to coincide with World Kidney Day. Professor Barton has been a tower of strength to the University of the West Indies in spearheading academic programs. He was chairman of the quality assurance of the clinical programs of UWI and coordinator monocampus for the accreditation of the medical degree program. He has also contributed to many communities in the Faculty of Medical Sciences and was the university examiner for undergrad and postgrad medical exam. He has received numerous awards locally and regionally and internationally. He was awarded the Order of Distinction by the Government of Jamaica in 2011. Our awardee has published over 200 papers in peer-reviewed journals and has supervised several research students. He is a member of many distinguished learned societies and a fellow of the American College of Physicians and fellow of the Royal College of Physicians of Edinburgh. Ladies and gentlemen, the University Diabetes Outreach Program is therefore proud to confer on this indefatigable teacher, researcher, clinician, and pioneer in nephrology, the Sir Phillip Sherlock Distinguished Award for outstanding achievements in the field of nephrology. We give to you Professor Barton. Professor Barton, congratulations, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, we now invite Professor Barton to speak on a subject that is close to his heart, diabetes and the kidney.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for your very generous comments. I want to congratulate the University Diabetes Outreach Program for its 21 years of bringing knowledge about diabetes and its complications to the community. I want to particularly congratulate Professor the Honorable Errol Morrison and Dr. Whitbourne Morrison for their staying power in seeing this organization through to this time and in keeping these conferences going. I want to particularly thank the Sir Phillip Sherlock Award Committee for their very generous award to myself and to my team, and I want to stress to my team of nurses, residents in internal medicine, fellows, social workers, and others who have assisted over the years in these outreach programs in the renal registry and in work in other Caribbean islands. This, I think, is a great tribute to that team, and they deeply appreciate your award. I think I go with this, does it? Yeah. All right. Yesterday, the conference started quite appropriately discussing cardiovascular disease in a conference titled Diabetes and the Kidney. And as I said, I thought that quite appropriate. The leading cause of mortality in patients with end-stage renal failure is cardiovascular disease. And we are aware that several of the traditional risk factors that cause cardiovascular disease also cause chronic kidney disease leading on to end-stage renal failure. But in addition, kidney disease in itself, because of all the metabolic perturbations that occur, because of the uremic milieu and oxidative stress that affects the heart, that affects the myocyte causing fibrosis, and because of the effect of the kidney on blood pressure itself, systemic blood pressure and intraglomerular blood pressure, and this topic came up yesterday and I shall say a little bit more about it, patients end up with various cardiovascular problems, the cardiomyopathy, the dilatation of all the four chambers of the heart, The anemia doesn't help in that regard either. It causes dilatation. The fistula we put on these patients to have them dialyze, increasing venous return to the heart, also causes cardiovascular disease and large enlargement of the heart. And so, when we look at this map, we can see why we have to do something, not only because of cardiovascular disease, but also because of renal disease, because of stroke, because of peripheral vascular disease. Let us look here in the Middle East. The prevalence of diabetes in 2000, said to be 15.2 million, but by 2030, it will be 42.6 million. Let us look in Africa, all right? 7 million, 2000, 18.2 million in 2030. Asia and Australia, 82.7 million, 2000 estimated, 190.5 million in 2030. Let us look at the Americas, and the Caribbean is often grouped with the Americas. 33 million, 2000, 66.8 million in 2030. It means, therefore, ladies and gentlemen, we need to break the chain, as Professor Reese said yesterday, and we need to break the chain very early, as I believe Dr. Faye Morrison said yesterday, early, so that we can prevent this happening in 2030 and beyond. The Caribbean is not spared. Let us look at the leading causes of death in Jamaica, and we see that number two for females, diabetes, males, third, diabetes, but we know that diabetes also relates to cerebrovascular and cardiovascular disease. I'm sorry, I need to pull this back a little bit. Then the overall leading causes of death, we see diabetes also there. It's in the top three for Jamaica. This is, the chairman mentioned about the outreach clinics, which have been held outside of Jamaica, Kingston. And I see Dr. Shoibo there, one of our lecturers and now a nephrologist at University Hospital. And he was an integral part, and still is an integral part, of these outreach clinics. This was taken from the Mandeville Hospital Clinic. Now, at that clinic in Mandeville, we see patients that come from part of St. Anne, Brownstown and beyond, Trelawney, some of Trelawney, that end of Trelawney, Clarendon, Manchester, St. Elizabeth. And when this was done, you can see diabetes mellitus is one of the leading causes in patients with kidney disease, followed by hypertension. Lupus is down here, and some others. From the Caribbean Renal Registry, the major causes of chronic kidney disease were hypertension, diabetes mellitus, that CGN means chronic glomerulonephritis, and again, lupus. And we can see here hypertension, diabetes, combination of hypertension and diabetes. I want to say something about this. Several of the patients come to us quite late, and they are documented as having kidney disease, chronic kidney disease, and it is written secondary to hypertension. Some of these patients, we believe, did not have hypertension as a result, initially, that the hypertension is secondary to the kidney disease. So certainly when you see a 23-year-old man with end-stage kidney disease, it is more likely that that individual would have something like chronic glomerulonephritis causing his kidney disease. So this year, I would tell you, does not refer just to patients who had initially hypertension and then developed chronic kidney disease. This group is quite important, and this came up yesterday. This says more or less the same thing, looking at males in the blue, females in the, is that brown? Hypertension, diabetes, combination of hypertension and diabetes with lupus. Again, I think some of these cases belong somewhere around here. There are several terms which have been used for kidney disease caused by diabetes. And I'll mention them, you don't have to remember them, they are the names of people. Kimmel Steele, who died in 1970, Wilson, who I think died in 1997. And it really refers to the description of what is seen under the microscope in the kidney, on the histology in the kidneys. And some people prefer to refer to the disease as an intercapillary glomerulonephritis. And diabetes does cause a glomerulonephritis, an inflammation within the vessels within the glomeruli of the kidney. Older diabetic patients have a higher chance of micro and macrovascular complications, and Professor Abel yesterday mentioned this to you, and we can see at the top there nephropathy, retinopathy, is it? Coronary artery disease, right? That's a macrovascular complication. We talk of different stages of kidney disease. And you may hear us talk about stage one and stage two and so on right up to stage five. Stage five is supposed to be the worst stage. This is tied to the rate at which the kidney filters out the bad substances. So if the filtration rate of the kidney, and the normal filtration rate should be somewhere between 88 and 120, but if the filtration rate is, say, 90 and above, and the patient has something like just protein in the urine, they are put in this category. If the filtration rate is somewhere between 60 and 90, they are put in this rate, this group. And if it's between 30 and 59, this group, 15 and 29, this group, and below 15, this group. So that's all what the stages mean. It depends on the filtration rate, which many of the laboratories now calculate when you send the blood to the lab. They send it back to you telling you what the urea and what the creatinine are. And I usually would say to the patients, if you don't remember the words urea and creatinine, you can forget them. Just think of impurities which the kidneys are filtering out. And they use those to calculate the rate. So stage just is tied to that. And we can see that early in kidney disease, the major early pathophysiological mechanism is hyperfiltration. So these patients start off filtering very high. I said the rate should be 88 to 150, to 120. We see some of them 180, right? And this creates problems in itself. Sclerosis, scarring of the kidney, and so on, and we'll come back to that. Okay, this says more or less the same thing except in graph form. Changes in hyperfiltration and macroalbuminuria with stages of kidney disease. Again, we can see here, this is the rate at which the kidney is filtering out bad substances, the years of diabetes, and we can see they start off with hyperfiltration, they get microalbuminuria here, right? And then they get overt proteinuria. This decreases somewhere around 20 years after diabetes when they get to end-stage kidney failure. These are some of the changes that occur in the kidney. This is a normal glomerulus, and the glomerulus is that, you can think of it as a little sort of powerhouse that does all the filtering out of bad substances in the kidney. Right, this is a normal one. You can see there's a difference here. You can see there are these areas here, right? These areas here, which you can consider scarred areas, right? You can see it more over here, right? And what also happens is in between, inside of these, you also get scarring and you also get fibrosis. Markedly into and damage to the small tubules that are important in the filtration here, so that the kidneys don't work well. They cannot carry out their function. Now, this is a very complex slide. There are probably just about four things I want you to take away from here. Of course, if you are a DM candidate in internal medicine, a fellow in nephrology, and a biochemistry person, you need to know it, right? We will ask you about it, and you may need to describe it to us. It is the basis of a lot of research that goes on, and you can, in fact, get your PhD and professorship on just one little area of what goes on here. But what I want you to take away is when glucose enters into certain kidney cells using these GLUT1 and SGLT that are non-insulin dependent co-transporters. They help to move the thing into the cell. A complex cascade of reactions occur. So that's the first message. High sugar in the cell causes a very complex reaction. Not simple at all. Pathways are generated, and the polyol pathway is somewhere around here. And these in themselves end up causing the final injury, the scarring to the kidney, the oxidative stress to the kidney. The other message I want you to take away is here. If there isn't a lot of sugar, sugar is not going to enter the cell. And so we have to do something here. The final message is if we are going to be dealing with new treatments for hypertension, preventing the complications of hypertension or mitigating these, we need to understand these pathways. Understand these steps, right? This product here, for instance, this one you see here, mark AGE, it simply means advanced glycosylated end products. And you have glucose attaching itself to certain proteins that then cause a cross-linking with certain cells in the kidney. And by cross-linking with these cells, an irreversible cross-linkage, it interferes with the function of these cells. And so somebody can get their PhD on just this area alone. Let's move on. This is another slide. I'm not going to go through all of it with you, but comorbidities can also worsen the problems within the kidney. So let's say somebody has diabetes, and they are also obese. You have a whole chain of reactions that occur, right? And Professor Abel talked yesterday about the mitochondrial dysfunction that occurs in patients with kidney disease, not only as it relates to the heart, but also to the kidney. And you see a whole range of reactions which occur because of this comorbidity in association with diabetes in the patient. But I may add that obesity in itself, without any diabetes mellitus, can cause chronic kidney disease. And some of you were here yesterday when Professor Rees spoke of Barker and Barker's theory and the experiments based on Barker's theory, that what happens in early childhood affects what happens to the man or woman later on. So that the small child, the malnourished child, may become obese, may become diabetic, and so can end up with cardiovascular disease and renal disease. It is said that the child is father of the man. Well, we need to say that the fetus is father of the man, because the intrauterine environment is also very important and can play a role in what happens to that individual for the rest of his life in terms of obesity and diabetes. Okay. This just shows you, we spoke of hyperfiltration, and this just shows you in a simple schematic way some of what goes on in the diabetic kidney. You have preglomerular vasodilatation of the vessels, you have intraglomerular hypertension, and you end up with the scarring I mentioned, and the tubules in the kidney, the spaces in between these, the interstitium, you end up with marked scarring causing proteinuria, and the parenchymal cells are unable to function as they should, and we have chronic kidney disease. Now, you will see that systemic hypertension here also contributes. But the patient who has got diabetes mellitus, we heard yesterday that they have a insulin resistance, hyperinsulinemia, which can cause hypertension. We also heard that there is also increased peripheral resistance, right, which can cause hypertension because of that physiological mechanism. But we also know that because of the structural injuries that take place in the kidney, these patients would develop also a secondary type of hypertension. They get hypertension from being diabetic and having kidney disease. Not only from these, but also from some other things which Professor Rees hinted at yesterday, and which Professor Abel also hinted at in the heart, the effect on mitochondria, the effect on cell death, what is referred to as apoptosis, and fibrosis within cell walls. Right? Also, there is interference with an important system in the kidney, something called the aldosterone, the renin-angiotensin aldosterone system, which is crucial in hypertension control, and that too can contribute to hypertension in the patient with diabetes and kidney disease. I think I showed you this already. We can see here all the marks scarring in the kidney. We can see the thickening of the blood vessels. We can see a few atrophic kidney tubules, and we see some increased cells out here also. Let us look at what we do now to prevent progression of diabetic nephropathy. We should, in the first instance, prevent diabetes altogether, and I think this was dealt with appropriately yesterday. We come back to this slide, and let us look at preventing hyperglycemia in itself, which will cut back on the preglomerular vasodilatation in these patients. So we need to go back to basics, as Dr. Morrison said yesterday. Lifestyle changes, try to prevent diabetes. And that says the same thing here. Right. When we do that, we prevent hyperglycemia, we prevent the oxidative stress, and you had a lot on that yesterday, and we prevent that chronic inflammation. And let me add that chronic kidney disease is considered, the patient is considered to be in a chronic inflammatory state, and chronic kidney disease is a risk factor for cardiovascular disease. Intensive insulin therapy has been shown to prevent diabetic nephropathy for, in fact, years after. And this is referred to as a metabolic memory. These cells retain the memory of this lowered glucose and still continue carrying out the good effect. And we can see here, this here is the cumulative incidence of impaired filtration of the kidney years since randomization. This is using conventional therapy. You are not tightly controlling the sugar. And we can see here that these patients here are doing better after about 25 years in terms of this. We go back to this using drugs. Angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitors. And these refer to such drugs as captopril and lisinopril and so on and so on. I have no share in the companies that produce those drugs. I just want to mention. And these here are angiotensin receptor blockers. And some of you will know these as losartan and rezillo and so on and so on. Telmisartan, ibasartan. Right. And these can have beneficial effect on the kidney in diabetes and diabetic nephropathy. Right? They can affect preglomerular vasodilatation, deal with systemic hypertension, oxidative stress, inflammation. And here we see a little study on using some of these drugs, and this is the cumulative proportion of microalbuminuria. And what is this saying? After months of the drug, this is angiotensin receptor blocker, and this is, well, I'm surprised this is here. Right, so let's move on. Combination of the angiotensin converting enzyme receptor inhibitors and the ARBs, yes, they can affect systemic hypertension, oxidative stress, and inflammation, but many studies have shown that they're really not beneficial combining them. Sometimes if the hyperfiltration is very high, like 180, we may combine them to see if we can bring it down, and sometimes I wonder if we are not really just treating ourselves. But there really isn't a beneficial effect from several studies. Okay, I've mentioned this. I don't think I will burden you with this. Oh, what's What about blood pressure control, renin, angiotensin, aldosterone, system inhibitors, glycemia, lipids? Yes. Treatment of these can affect how we do, and this is a summary of more or less what I was telling you, that when we treat with the things we've discussed before, only the genetic factors, which we really can't do anything about, remain. So it is important that we treat these patients when they come to us. It's even more important if we can prevent diabetes and therefore prevent its impact on the organs. When patients spill protein in their urine, when they spill albumin in their urine, not only is that protein a marker which we can use to say this patient will go on to chronic kidney disease, which may be severe, but it is also a marker of cardiovascular disease. It is telling you that this patient may have microvascular and macrovascular complications, which can end up affecting the heart also, the vessels in the brain causing stroke. So we refer to protein in the urine, we take it seriously, and I know patients take it seriously, because if they were 1+ and they come back and it is 2+, you see them in tears. How did it go up to 2+? And you have to explain to them that it does vary with time and so on and so on. This is a marker of chronic kidney disease progression and cardiovascular disease. Now, one of the, in that diagram which I showed you, the very complex one, there are a whole lot of intermediates and so on which are released. Now, NRF2 is referred to as nuclear factor 2, and it regulates antioxidants. And a study was done using one of these drugs to see how it affects the kidney, that is, how it affects glomerular filtration, rate at which the kidney filters, and how it affects excretion of protein. And it did, in the randomized trial, it did increase glomerular filtration rate, made it better, and it did decrease proteinuria. But the study had to be terminated because the primary composite endpoint, that is, cardiovascular disease and death, was increased in the group that got the drug. It was causing more heart failure, and so it was terminated, and we don't use it. Okay, this is more or less saying the same thing I just mentioned, right? Heart failure, oh sorry, I pressed the wrong one, but right, this is saying the same thing I just mentioned. And this explains it. They did reduce, it's their proteinuria and increased GFR, but there was an increased risk of heart failure in these patients. So that is using just one part of that complex equation I gave you. I hope they still gave this person his PhD, because he would have put a lot of work into it. And I think we can give PhD for things that turn out bad. Right. There is also a trial using pentoxifilin. And let's move on. It affects renal failure or kidney disease in terms of it decreases protein excretion in patients with kidney disease. and its effect is really on what we call the RAS system in the kidney, the renin-angiotensin aldosterone system. Okay, and we can see here, these are the, which is it? These are the control groups here, is it? No, control groups here. These are those with pentoxifilin, and we can see that there is, is that the other way around, is it? These are the control, this is pentoxifilin, and we can see more preservation of the glomerular filtration rate with those on pentoxifilin. And this shows it that there is improvement in the GFR and there is less protein excretion in the patients on pentoxifilin. And the result is even better if you combine pentoxifilin with a RAS inhibitor. Right. What the side effects of that would be, I was not able to see all the side effects, but in vitro and animal studies have shown that improvement in the rate of filtration of the kidney and improvement in the decline in proteinuria are beneficial to the patient. What about ongoing and upcoming trials for the treatment of diabetic nephropathy? We go back this, and there are these inhibitors which are said to treat diabetes and diabetic nephropathy, and again they prevent preglomerular hypertension, intraglomerular hypertension, oxidative stress, inflammation. This is too small for you to read. And all this is saying here is that this is a trial which is still going on. In fact, they were still recruiting patients for this study. And again, going back to that original schematic with the complex schematic, they are taking one aspect of that, seeing if they can block certain things in it, and if this can help decrease or mitigate diabetic kidney disease. Vitamin D. This is interesting. It is said to assist with systemic hypertension and oxidative stress. And we have this little schematic here showing how vitamin D can impinge on all this whole range of mechanisms here, decreasing the renal fibrosis and the progressive renal function loss. Okay. And there are quite a few studies on these, and you can combine this with all the other drugs which you used, the RAS inhibitors, ACE inhibitors, angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitors. Lowering uric acid, patients with chronic kidney disease, from whatever cause, may have increased uric acid, and that's a substance which causes gout. And not only could it affect the kidney, uric acid, if you high uric acid, or cardiovascular colleagues are particularly interested in it also, because it can be a marker of cardiovascular disease also. And here we see that lowering uric acid may prevent diabetic nephropathy prevention. And in increasing uric acid, you end up here and you end up having diabetic nephropathy. And there are various studies, mostly on type 1 diabetes, but they're also on type 2 diabetes. Of the beneficial effect. This says almost the same thing. While some reports have come out of that, they are recruiting now. I think this is still going on. And there's a major study, multi-center study going on with this. Endothelin antagonists, because of the problems that occur in blood vessels, the release of this substance, which is quite a vasoconstrictor and can send the blood pressure up, we want to find things that are going to block this and which would help particularly this part of things. So this is, again, another thing coming out of understanding the pathways of diabetic nephropathy from that complex slide. Now, the CCL2 and so on, these are sort of chemokines. There are some of these intermediaries which are produced when glucose enters the kidney cell and causes that big complex reaction that takes place. And some people are saying, look, let us see how we can inhibit these and see how we can stop and treat diabetes, diabetic nephropathy, and how we can mitigate chronic kidney disease in these patients. And this, again, is quite complex. I just want you to see that the high glucose environment, remember this product I mentioned to you, the advanced glycosylated products, right? How they can cause effect upon the parenchymal cells on the monocytes, right? Causing really, there are various other factors that are involved. MRCP1, again, you want to consider that. MCP1. Again, you can refer that to some of these intermediaries which are produced when sugar goes into the cell, how in the long run they can cause injury, apoptosis, cell death, necrosis, fibrosis, and progression of kidney disease. And what people are saying, let us find inhibitors to these to see how we can help. The Janus kinase, that's a similar one of these intermediaries which they are working on also, right? I won't spend much time on this, and that trial is ongoing at the moment. And there's a lot of successful animal experiments taking place. So based on what I have said there about these new treatments, the main purpose is to cut the pathophysiological links, right? And if we look here, we can see, and this is going to be my summary slide, the solid lines refer to what we are doing. I don't think this thing is. The solid line refers to what we are doing now, this. Right, this is what we are doing now. Potential treatment sites based on that diagram of what happens in the cell when glucose enters. These are potential, and there are a lot of trials. There are a lot of trials going on with these. The whole purpose is to prevent this. And to prevent this. So while we want to stop diabetes, prevent it, while we want to prevent diabetic nephropathy, there are steps taken based upon the pathophysiology to block some of these links so that we don't get here with these patients. And when we get here, it means that dialysis units will go out of service and we may have no need for them. The dialysis nurses, I, I don't want you to take me to task afterwards. All right? So finally, we get back to that point, which we must always make: early glycemic control, early control of blood pressure, salt, using what we have available. And there are the new trials which are trying to interrupt some of those pathophysiological links to prevent diabetic nephropathy. And in the last century, when I was a medical student, we thought all of this was out of space. But you can see the helicopter bringing it, and it's almost over University Hospital. So it's pretty close. Thank you all very much.
Thank you very much, Prof. Barton. In fact, it's quite a consolation for him to mention the last century, because I also was trained in the last century. So we... this has been, in fact, a really wonderful lecture. In keeping with the quality of our Sir Phillip Sherlock awardees, the professor emphasized that prevention is the best approach, and that we need to address the pathophysiology of diabetic nephropathy, especially to prevent renal vasodilatation, glomerular hypertension, and end-stage effect of glomerular sclerosis. I was very intrigued with his summary of the new treatment options that we have, because most of us who have to treat and see diabetic patients oftentimes feel a sense of despair. And we have oftentimes reflected on the possibility that this is a process that is inevitable. And now we're very happy to know that it can be halted and in some cases reversed. We'd now like to invite you for 5 minutes to ask the prof any questions that's on your mind. And I see Hafi ready to go. Go ahead, Hafi.
I have two questions, if you will indulge me. The first one is, as a clinician, are you saying to me that when I see a type 2 diabetic, in addition to the 6 drugs that they're on, namely a sulfonylurea, a biguanide, a DPP-4 inhibitor, a statin, and whatever else, I must now add pentoxifilin, an ACE inhibitor, and allopurinol? That's the first question. Mm-hmm. The second question is, I'm intrigued by the fact that you said obesity alone causes renal insufficiency. Is it something that we are missing? Can you advise us on, should we be doing microalbumin on our obese patients? And do they go with end-stage renal failure onto dialysis?
Yes, let me take the last one first. Patients with obesity may develop a type of glomerulonephritis, which is characterized histologically after we do a kidney biopsy. It's referred to as focal and segmental glomerulosclerosis. And this can be quite difficult to treat in some cases. And it is, as a result, I could have gone in further and spent this whole talk on obesity, showing you all of those intermediaries which are released and which damage the kidney, damage the interstitium of the kidney, the mesangium. So yes, and persons who are obese are at risk, not only for heart disease and hypertension and diabetes, they're at risk for kidney disease. And persons next, their relatives, should be screened also for this disease. The other thing is, I don't want you to put patients on 20 medications, right? I think certainly what you have, you mentioned the ACE inhibitors or angiotensin receptor blockers. They usually would need allopurinol if they have chronic kidney disease and have elevated uric acid. I don't think that I would ask you to put those on unless they are required. I think you would already have them on things which I think can mitigate the diabetic nephropathy. Control, proper control of the blood sugar, proper control of hypertension, dealing with the proteinuria, which the ACE inhibitors and the angiotensin receptor blockers can deal with. You may not need to bring pentatoxifilin in there. And the uric acid if that is elevated. I am very wary about putting people on 20 medications. They usually can't afford to buy them. They don't take them, even if they can buy them.
Yes, question and comment. Is kidney disease hereditary? But the reason I'm asking that, I have 7 brothers, all of us are diabetic on insulin. 4 cousins, all of them are diabetic on insulin. One, my brother died and one of my cousins died. My son was diagnosed with diabetes at age 4. He died at age 32 from renal failure. And my grandson was born with diabetes and he died at age 16. I want to know if it's hereditary.
Yes. You're asking if what is hereditary, the diabetes? Okay. What you have mentioned is kidney disease as a result of diabetes, and certainly diabetes can in fact run in families and can in fact be hereditary. As far as kidney disease in itself goes outside of diabetes, there are hereditary causes of kidney disease. But I think you are dealing specifically with diabetes in the family leading on to chronic kidney disease.
Thank you very much, Prof. Barton. And in the spirit of UDOP, please give him a recognition.